Okay, start telling me your story.
Time came, we started going, and we came out from the fortress outside. Then they have the wagons separated. Two wagons, there has to be some other place, and we have us sitting in one wagon. And we was going, came to the like a woods, and they started robbing us over there. One by one, we had to stay in the line to be robbed. And from there, then we started again. They take Turkish soldiers, they are taking a rest over there. We are taking a rest too, but they are doing the robbing. And a time came, we left, and we went to another place, another wood, and still they are robbing. They are looking the dress seams and or coat seams and or dresses in the any place that you can hide any dollar, any American dollar or American Turkish dollar, Turkish gold pieces. Then on, they rob us much as they can. Then we went to the, how many weeks later? I don't know. I don't remember that much. 2 weeks or 10 days, but I don't think so. It was more than 2 weeks. Then we went to some desert. It had a wagon. It's they call the skele, I don't know. There's some place they took us which had the bridge, and I had to go to the bridge. My mother says, don't go, but I had to go to the bridge because I had to go do. And when I went there and I saw underneath the bridge all bodies, woman and men, everything. And my mother started crying, and I went out, and my mother says, stay here and do it over here. We stayed there, we did whatever duty we have to do it, and we started going to the wagon. And Turkish people, they said, come on, get in the wagon because we have to travel another place. We're not going to go over here. They was going to kill us over there, but they didn't kill us over there. They kill us. We was going to the Mardin's desert. Then we went to the desert. They stopped us. It is still woods. One part is wood, one part is nothing. They had a very big veil over there. Well, then they started getting all the men's, and my father took it. My father says, I am American citizen. Don't forget, I am American citizen. My children is American citizen. But they didn't care. They took him, and they started killing other people, and they killed my father. Time came. They throw him in the well, and they said to him, you want to be a Turk, national religion? Then you come out. He says, yes. And he brought it out. Then when he comes out, he started change his mind. Then they throw him again. Second time, they brought him up. Still he changed it. Then third time, when they throw him up outside, and they brought it up, they cut his neck. Then he couldn't talk anymore. And I remember his head was jumping around like a ball. But we was crying. I was special. I was crying because I was about 6 and a half, 7 years old. I remember everything.
Defense of Shatak, 40 kilometers south of the crow flies, south of Van, began on April 4th, 1915, and it extended to May 12th, 1915. And the first thing that happened in the how we got into this fight, that the Kurdish and Turkish forces in surrounding villages were massacring the Armenians, and some of these Armenians escaped to Shatak Ta, really, which is the center of the province. And we got news that Turks were up to no good. Then from Van, Ishkan and 3 others were sent by Cevdet, the governor of the vilayet, or state of Van, sent them. Then he sent also gendarmes who trapped them a day's journey away and killed them. News came to us of this too, and we knew that the hour of reckoning was at hand. So on April 4, 1915, the first shots were fired, and the battle was joined. We had elementary material, but during the fighting, my father got hold of some tin, sheets of tin, and with the wiring of that he had cut off telegraph wiring, he fashioned a cannon, and this roared and more gave us courage than did damage to the Turkish positions across the river from us. But it was a life or death struggle, of course, and we lasted for the duration to May 12th, when the advancing Russian army with the avant-garde, the front of the army, composed of General Drow, with 1,000 or so, battalion of 1,000 men, came to within a day's journey, and on April 12th, the Turks fled. The forces fled. The two cannons that they were firing at us, plus some 150 Turkish and 2,000 or so Kurdish forces that were fighting us, they all fled.
What happened to your father?
One night, I woke up, and right across the street, Lusinians, they were banging their door. They wanted
Who?
Mr. Lusinian, our neighbor, to come out. And my mother evidently had the premonition, but started crying. I woke up and I saw my mother crying, and my father had his arm around her. And it took only minutes. They finally got Mr. Lusinian.
Who's they?
The police, Turkish police. They took him out of the house, and barely a few minutes later, they banged our door, because the houses are very close by, you know, and banged our door, and they took my father. They asked the Turkish gendarmes and the police. They went through the houses, and when I'm mentioning this, please understand that this was going on from not only in our city, in every section of our city, but in the orphanages. I found out later they had followed the same modus operandi everywhere else. They were doing the same thing. All the notable and the able-bodied men, they were arresting and putting them in prison prior to getting the people out on deportation, or what I call death marches.
And what did they tell you? Why did they take your father? What did they say?
Evidently, it's very difficult for the American people or others to understand the mentality of the Turkish government over there. There is no question about it. Come out. We are taking you down to the government building or some such thing. They're not given any reason. Any democratic country where you know about the personal rights and freedoms and so on did not exist over there. They bang the door, they are armed, you're not, and that's it, out.
Tell me what happened to you and your brother.
When the gendarme and police find our place where we were, they came and took us. And we just escaped the other house, which was full of the people of Armenians, and they threw us in the street, the Turks.
What happened to your brother?
My aunt went, she was escaped again, to her neighbor and begged him, the Turk, the Sheikh Abdul, asked him and begged him that she is with us, with Asr Efendi, both children, daughter and son, and she will pay him whatever he wants. So they agreed a sum of Turkish gold lira, and he agreed to come and pick us up from that group who were going to die.
Then what happened?
Then we were at his home. My aunt was talking to the Armenian, but they forced us, the Sheikh forced us, me and my brother, to talk only Turkish. if you're going to talk Armenian, we will kill you. My aunt was a servant-like, but they were calling her Margaret Hanum. She was cooking, she was cleaning the house, everything, but they were just keeping us. The last month, when the Russian army was close to come, the Arabas and army people, horses were running, and the children came and called my brother to go together to see. Then a policeman who was coming and seeing my father all the time, and when he was talking to my father, he was always saying, "Your honor, your honor." Bendeniz, bendeniz, efendimize yabaylan. So he knew, he recognized my brother and asked him, "Are you Astur Efendi's son?" He said, "Yes." "And come on with me." The police take him, and we couldn't see him anymore. The children ran to house and started calling me, "Your brother was taken off, taken." So this was my brother's end.
You didn't see his end?
But I didn't see it. When Russian army came, and we were hundreds of parts of difficulties, we were saved. One little boy came to the same house when we were kept under the Russian army and Armenian volunteers. There were only 27 Armenian women and children saved from the Bitlis city, where the Armenians were more than Turks, and I don't remember exact number how many thousands they were.
Before we started, I ate a little, but all of a sudden we heard a gunshot in the air. Then just see from all over, from three sides and four sides, all this mob running to, hollering and swinging swords and clubs and metal, anything they had in their hands. And started first taking all the clothes and asking for money and jewelry and everything and pushing people around. But there was not a sound coming from the people, not a cry or get scared or scream. It was just silent besides that what they shout. Then they started taking their clothes, good clothes and things. Then I see one man, somebody must have told the Turk that the lady, her name was Yersa Kandarian. I remember so well. Somebody knocked him down and then cut the stomach up and looked for some money. Suppose she had swallowed some gold coins or jewelry. They started searching in it. But there was nobody scared or anything, nobody screamed. Then they, all over, they was just hitting and killing. And they come to around my mother, right away, she had the baby in her arm. And mostly she was protecting me because I was the oldest. I thought maybe they would kill me first. So then they knocked me on the head. I fell down. I don't remember what happened after that. Then when I wake up at midnight, I don't know what the time really was, but approximately, but only I see a moonlight that shine all over every thousands of people dead over there. And just moonshine on their face and some of without clothes, without anything.
In Mazra, where we were living, the Turkish town crier came and said that be ready. In about a couple of days, we're going to take you to another city. And nobody hardly believed that. But 2 days later, some of those gendarmes came and with their rifle butts hit the doors, get out over there and get into the bunch, and we're going to take you to another city. All we're doing is transporting you. And that night, on the outskirts of Malatya, they separated the boys and the men, the boys over 10 years old, to one side of the city of Malatya, and the children and the women to the other side. That night, we heard a lot of rifle shots, and we saw the flashes on the other side of the city. And a boy about 15 years old, he somehow or other had managed to escape and came to the bunch and said that, forget about all the men were killed by the Turks, massacred in cold blood. And so they dressed this boy into a girl's clothing and put some mud on his face so he wouldn't look like a beautiful girl, that the Turkish gendarmes wouldn't run away with them. Then they took us towards the Arabian desert. But on the shores of the Euphrates River, one day, they picked up all the boys from 5 to 10 years old, and they put us in a bunch. I happened to be at the bottom of the bunch. And then they started with their bayonets and swords and start killing us. One of the swords just hit me in this my cheek. Luckily, I was at the bottom of the pile, but I couldn't cry, I couldn't make no noise, because if I did, I wouldn't be here today.
Most of the Armenians in Malatya were tradesmen, gunsmiths, jewelers, artisans, and so on. I was saved from the Holocaust because my aunt had learned shoemaking from her husband, and she went to the Turkish officials and told them what she could do, and they thought this was a good idea, and they called her essential to be kept back for her got to go into their homes where the women weren't allowed to come out in public and measure their feet, build shoes, and bring it to them. And she was allowed to take her immediate family with her, and she made me her son and my mother her sister, and of course her mother was her mother, so that's how we were saved. And we were at first, the town crier came and announced that every Armenian had to go out to this particular place, to be marched to this particular place, a big field outside the city. And there they separated different groups to be taken or marched to different sections in the country, to the Syrian deserts or wherever. And we were in the group to be brought back. And from then on, of course, we were brought back to our own homes. And it was not very safe situation. We had to be very careful.
When my father returned, it was, of course, a miracle. And mother was so overjoyed because we thought he was dead. And it was amazing the condition he was in when we saw him, all in rags, and it looked as if he hadn't eaten for weeks and months, etc. But in a short time after he arrived, life went back to normal, and the war had ended, the World War had ended, so we were somewhat protected again by the English and the French, and things seemed to be normal when suddenly the town crier again went through town and again announced that men between the ages of so-and-so and so-and-so had to report to the city. And father said, I am not going to go in again this time. But I didn't know this. Mother didn't tell me about this. And as far as I was concerned, my father was taken away with the rest of the men. Well, the reason mother didn't tell me was that what they would do is take little children like myself and hang them in a bag from the ceiling and beat them until they told the Turks, if they knew anyone who was hiding had not reported in town to the town meetings, and where they were taken away. And of course, one of the children across the street from us was picked up this way and beaten until he was killed. And there was this fear that I might do the same thing.